Thank you, Justice Benjamin. I'd now like to introduce our second panellist, Jojo Mehta, co-founder and executive director of Stop Ecocide, alongside the late barrister and legal pioneer, Polly Higgins. To support the establishment of ecocide as a crime at the International Criminal Court, Jojo, as key spokesperson and executive director of Stop Ecocide International, has overseen the growth of the movement, teams in 15 countries, websites in 9 languages, while coordinating legal developments, diplomatic traction and public narrative. She is chair of the charitable Stop Ecocide Foundation and convener of the independent expert panel for the legal definition of ecocide. I would like to invite Jojo Mehta to speak to the summit. Jojo, 15 minutes, please.
Thank you. Would you like me to get the podcast there?
Yes, wherever you're most comfortable.
Thank you. Dear gracious hosts and organisers, and distinguished guests and attendees, both here and online, it's a real honour to be here today, and thank you so much to Globe for organising. Last year, Joe Kaeser, then CEO of German company Siemens, was challenged over the company's provision of equipment for the Adani coal mine project in Australia. His response was regretful. While I have a lot of empathy for environmental matters, I do need to balance different interests of different stakeholders as long as they have lawful legitimation for what they do. We all know you can't ask for a government permit to kill people for your new business venture. But you can ask a government for a mining, drilling, or logging license that could significantly destroy ecosystems, destabilize the climate, and demolish ancient sacred sites along the way. It is the lawful legitimation of such projects at their most devastating which enables the continuing destruction of Earth's vital and precious ecosystems. This is ecocide, a root cause of the climate and ecological crisis. It means that with all the goodwill and ambition in the world, we are still only crawling in the direction we should be sprinting in, to reach not only net zero, which is merely a necessary first step, but to reach a world which has half a chance of thriving. We are right now simply trying to play our familiar game better, and it's an incredibly dangerous game. Essentially, we're dancing with fiduciary duties at the edge of a precipice, without a guardrail. What if we actually changed the rules of the game and put that guardrail in place? What if we recoiled in a healthy way from destroying habitats, species, and the very cultures which know how best to guard them, just as we recoil from mass murder? Governments, for example, should not be held to ransom via investor-state dispute settlements for the future profits of fossil fuel corporations when the International Energy Agency has clearly stated we must keep fossil fuels in the ground. What if there were a rule that removed impunity, keeping fiduciary duties out of that game? This is what an international crime of ecocide will do, creating individual criminal responsibility for key decision makers at the highest level. At first glance, it might seem that it's all about putting the bad guys in the dock. And once it's in place, prosecutions will indeed be able to be taken in any ratifying jurisdiction. But this is not the true aim. It's fundamentally about changing norms and deterring the harmful practices by creating the necessary parameter for a genuine shift of direction. It's about creating a new and healthy taboo in the form of personal criminal responsibility. As of June this year, there is a legal definition of ecocide, drafted by a panel of top international criminal and environmental lawyers from around the world, convened by our foundation and chaired by Philippe Sands QC and Dior Falso. The core text is just one sentence. Ecocide means unlawful or wanton acts committed with knowledge that there is a substantial likelihood of severe and either widespread or long-term damage to the environment being caused by those acts. It's simple and clear, it's based strongly on legal precedent, and it addresses the worst harms while also taking account of and reinforcing existing laws that may vary from one jurisdiction to another. It does this by the means of the two thresholds contained in it. one addressing the severity of potential harm, and the second, the illegality or recklessness of the act or omission. Also, like some of the other crimes listed in the Rome Statute, it is framed as a crime of endangerment, not of material harm. Just as directing an attack against a civilian population is a war crime, regardless of actual harm to that population, so acts threatening severe environmental harm will constitute a crime in and of themselves when ecocide is placed alongside genocide, war crimes, and crimes against humanity. Which, when you think about it, is very sensible in the case of ecosystem damage, since we don't want to have to wait until half the planet is destroyed before working our way back to find who is at fault. Insurers, investors, CEOs and policymakers, and indeed the public at large, all know in our hearts that profound change is needed if we're to emerge from this crisis not unscathed. We only have to watch the news to see that it's already too late for that, but with a fighting chance of surviving and thriving. Which is probably why 16 member states of the International Criminal Court are already publicly talking about ecocide law at government or parliamentary level. Bangladesh, Brazil, Bolivia, Belgium, Canada, Chile, Finland, France, Luxembourg, the Maldives, Mexico, the Netherlands, Spain, Sweden, the UK and Vanuatu. The conversation is also active with our gracious hosts here in Scotland, as well as the European Parliament, the Nordic Council and the Interparliamentary Union. A number of other states are also in conversation on the subject, behind closed doors, even if they may not be ready to speak out yet. So it's clear, this law is on its way. Insurance executives and political advisers are already telling us they know it's coming, they just don't know exactly when. We estimate that states could be ratifying it within 4 or 5 years. And while that may seem slow, when we're aware of the terrifying apocalypse of fires and floods already unfolding, this time is needed to prepare for its arrival because the implications will be broad, and necessarily so. Ecocide law is not a distraction from other more immediate actions addressing climate, legal or otherwise. All those other actions are deeply supported by its very approach. This isn't about tinkering at the edges of how many toxins can we use without breaching regulation. It's about genuinely levelling the playing field, protecting life, and empowering practical and positive change. It's a long overdue health and safety law for the planet. Our collective work is now to welcome it for the lifeline it quite literally offers, and to do this by preparing the ground, both legally, in terms of increasing training, knowledge, jurisprudence and research in areas of environmental harm, improving regulation and strengthening enforcement of existing crimes, and in collaboration with the corporate world regarding the adaptations to method and scale that will be required in practice to bring human economic activity back within a safe operating space. And by the way, the corporate world is already starting to call for this law. Just 2 weeks ago, the International Corporate Governance Network, a network of global asset managers, including names such as BlackRock and UBS, included in its statement to the COP26 presidency a recommendation, and I quote, to mandate regulation and collaborate internationally to criminalise ecocide. Much of what we need to move forward in a new way is already available. Renewable energy, circular economies, regenerative agriculture, and so on. Now it's time to activate and prepare for a law that will actually support these solutions and many more besides. In a few short years, I believe the Mr. Kaysers of this world will be answering differently about what is covered by lawful legitimation, and they and our planet will feel much better for it. Thank you.